Hey guys, 2 weeks ago I went up to Globe, Arizona and gave a presentation at the conference there about my research on Salado Polychrome called Where is Salado? And so today I'm going to give that to you in video format here. Stephen Lexon said, I write history by connecting the dots. The British call this method interpretive archaeology. So in this presentation, I'm going to run through a bunch of data and ideas that different archaeologists and anthropologists have put forth. I'm going to run through those pretty quickly, and then I'm going to connect some dots. I'm going to put together some ideas and make some assumptions. Some of those dots are pretty far apart, not necessarily close together, so I'm making some broad assumptions. First, let's define what Salado is. When I'm talking about Salado, I'm not talking about anything but Salado polychrome pottery. I'm not talking about some Salado phenomenon. I'm not talking about a Salado culture. I'm not talking about Salado people. I'm just talking about the pottery. So where is Salado is an important question. Where did it originate? Where did the materials come from? Where was the source of inspiration? Where was the motivation? Evidence points to a long-term, ongoing connection between the Salado and the upper Little Colorado River Basin. And so this presentation is going to look at those connections and then draw some assumptions based on that. Let's look at the origins of Salado. Let's see where it started. If we look at this map, one on the upper right is the Archaeology Southwest map. Their description of this is, for the green area, is the distribution shown for Pinto polychrome reflects the area in which it comprises a substantial portion of the decorated pottery, 20% or more for that time period. So let's not look at the red now. The red is your regular Salado polychrome, non-Pinto. So Pinto is a little different. And Pinto is where it started. And so we see here they have listed 1280 to 1330 Pinto polychrome in the green area. It started mostly above the rim. When I say the rim, I'm talking about the Mogollon Rim, the escarpment that runs east to west through most of Arizona. Pinto polychrome began above the rim. This is important because above the rim is not typical what's considered Salado country. That's not the area where Salado polychromes are most commonly found during their main time period. So it started above the rim in this area in green. Now, at the same time that Pinto polychrome was starting out, another type was also starting out. So if we look in the lower right-hand corner here on this map, this is the map drawn by Carlson in his report on White Mountain Redwares. And this is the distribution for Pinedale black on red and Pinedale polychrome. And he says, the distribution of Pinedale polychrome and Pinedale black on red, solid area, area of greatest concentration. So here on the left, I've kind of superimposed those two maps as best I can because these maps I have to deal with are kind of vague. So I've tried to superimpose them to show that the area where Pinedale polychrome was first made and where it was most concentrated is almost the same as the area where Pinto polychrome was first made. So we see that events on the rim, events in an area that we consider like Western Pueblo or Mountain Mogollon, even though those aren't considered, you know, core Salado areas, they have a important impact on Salado polychrome. Pinto polychrome was the beginning of its kind. It was the start of a new type of pottery that we call Roosevelt Redware or Salado polychromes. Likewise, Pinedale polychrome was the start, was the beginning of a new type, that Western type of White Mountain Redware, the Mogollon Rim style of White Mountain Red. Before then, White Mountain Redware had all been made quite a ways to the east in Zuni area, and around where the Zuni Reservation is today is where White Mountain Red, where's the St. John's polychrome Wingate, had been made. Suddenly, boom, they're being made in a different area. At exactly the same time, Pinto polychrome begins to be made in the same area. Using the same designs, using that Pinedale style of decoration, but in different traditions. Pinedale being made on a White Mountain Redware, a Zuni-type tradition. Pinto being made on more of a Mogollon, Puerco Redware-type tradition. So let's look at some of the other events on the rim that had to do with that. And the first one we're going to talk about is these Puerco Valley Redwares. So Puerco Valley Redwares and the predominant type that we're talking about in that grouping is Xolo Black on Red, were the first oxidized organic paint pottery. That is, pottery which is painted with organic paint, like Anasazi Black on White, lots of that is painted with organic paint. But this is different in that it's oxidized. The reds are allowed to oxidize. Your Mesa Verde style organic paint pottery is smothered to keep it from oxidizing. So those clays don't turn into like yellows or creams as they would if they were oxidized, but they make a nice bright, solid, stark white because they're deprived of oxygen. So this is oxidized organic paint pottery. It was first started around 1030 The center of production was the Puerco River Valley. So that's roughly like if you've ever driven I-40 from about Holbrook to the New Mexico state line, right in that follows up the Puerco River. And it was part of the Mogollon ceramic tradition. And this information comes from Prehistoric Ceramics of the Puerco Valley by Kelly Hayes Gilpin and Eric Van Hartsfeld. Other thing that was happening at exactly the same time, that time when Pinto polychrome first began to be made and when Pinedale polychrome first began to be made, that 1275 to 1300 time period, village aggregation and these new pottery types. So village aggregation, what do I mean by that? Smaller villages were being abandoned. People were moving together and making large, massive villages. So during this time, lots of small villages were destroyed, were abandoned. People came together and built these huge pueblos. And these this quote here talks about how they were came together into 40 large nucleated towns. And then there's another quote here where he talks about the scale of construction increased rapidly in almost every portion of the study area between AD 1275 and 1279. The transition to nucleated plaza-oriented settlements was probably complete before 1300. This is talking about the area above the rim. We have massive cultural change at the same time that these two polychrome potteries were first made. So this brief 25-year period, 1275 to 1300, roughly, corresponds with the birth of Salado polychrome and Mogollon Rim White Mountain Redware. Where and how was Salado polychrome developed then in this area? What was it based on? The birth of Salado polychrome. Here we have a quote from Kelly Hayes Gilpin, Dennis Gilpin, saying that Pinto polychrome was based on these Puerco redwares, this Sholo black on red. So the only difference was it has a Pinedale type design pattern and it has a white slip instead of a red slip. Otherwise, the technology used to make it, the types of clay, temper, slip, whatever, are identical to those used on the Sholo black on red. So there's a connection there. This type, Sholo black on red, evolves into Pinto polychrome with the coming of Kayenta into the area, bringing this Pinedale style design. Here's another quote. This one's from Susan Lynn Stinson. It shows evidence that Pinto polychrome was first made on the Mogollon Rim. In fact, she goes on to speculate that it was at Bailey Ruins specifically where Pinto polychrome was first made, where it was invented. And this is interesting because we may not know where Pinedale polychrome was first made, but we do know that it was made at Pinedale Ruin because there were pottery found there in the ruins, unfired pottery of Pinedale polychrome. So we know it was being made at Pinedale Ruin. This Bailey Ruin, where they have evidence that Pinto polychrome was first made, is only a few miles away. Maybe 5, 6, 7 miles at most. So pretty close there in one small area, we have both of these types being created and then spreading outward from that. So very interesting. And the fact that they're both built on different traditions. Remember, the Pinto polychrome was built on that Mogollon tradition, that Puerco redwares, whereas White Mountain redware, same design style, very similar designs, very similar looks, was built on the White Mountain redware tradition. So different types of clay, different types of temper, a different firing environment, but in some ways very similar and came out of the same area at the same time. After this happens, what happens next? We find that Salado polychrome spreads rapidly to the south and far to the east. So this map shows the original area where Pinto polychrome was made and distributed widely, 1275 to 1300. I think the Archaeology Southwest map said 1330, but right in there. And then we have Salado polychrome, the main area. When Gila polychrome took off, it took off huge over this big area. And then we had Tonto polychrome, and then you have things like Phoenix polychrome and Nine Mile polychrome and Dinwiddie polychrome. So you have other types within this range of 150 years. And the interesting thing is when this new pottery type, when this Salado polychrome hits the southern southwest, that is the area below the rim. Remember before we've been talking about things that happened above the rim. When this hits below the rim and really spreads, then we find the same similar kind of cultural changes that we had above the rim when these new pottery types grew. And that is rapid cultural change, village abandonment, consolidating into larger pueblos. So here's a quote that talks about the conflicts that happened in the Tonto Basin in this time period. Widespread and thorough burning of structures in the Tonto Basin suggests that conflict increased after 1300. All settlements within the project area were abandoned by AD 1325, and only a single large settlement at Schoolhouse Point remained on the south side of the Salt River. This reflects a pattern seen throughout the Tonto Basin and Greater Southwest at this time, where smaller sites were aggregating into a few large villages. So this sounds identical to what was going on above the rim 25 years before this. That is, village aggregation, new pottery types. Bang. Another quote here. Most important, the present study suggests ceramic production patterns during the early classic period also shifted dramatically with the production of new ceramic forms. So we have village aggregation, new pottery types. As a nice Gila polychrome bowl showing the difference in design styles between Pinto and Gila. So quite a bit different design style, but same technology, still built on that Puerco redware tradition. What else happened in this area at the same time that might have given us some clues as to what was going on? We have the genesis of the Kachina religion at that same time. 1320 is the time when images of Kachina first began to appear on pottery and rock art. Same place. So the place where we start seeing these images of Kachina is Upper Little Colorado River Valley. So same time, same place. Same groups involved. Now, this is the most interesting thing. There's linguistic evidence for a Zuni presence in the classic Ho'okam. And the most interesting thing is a lot of these loan words relate to religion. So let me read this quote here. The content of these loan words is consistent with an association with the Kachina cult. The Zuni word koko for good Kachina is the Tono O'odham word kokoi for ghost, spirit of the dead. The Hopi form is koko, as in kokosori, a Kachina, or kuko, as in kukopolo, a Kachina with a hunchback, which is, of course, the English kokopelli. The direction of loan is likely to be O'odham to Zuni to Hopi. So here we have not only a connection where these pottery types spread from the rim to below the rim to the desert areas, expand greatly. We have the same kind of actions, village aggregation, and new pottery types. But we also have this new religion springing up at exactly that same moment in history. And we know that people in the southern Southwest, the O'odham, that is like the Pimas in southern Arizona, are now connected religiously in some way to the Zuni, who were the people where that Cibola, that White Mountain Redware pottery tradition came from. So there is definitely a connection, almost a chain of events there. The other thing about the Kachina religion, it's not just a religion that is practiced only in villages, only with, we think of it as something where they have dances and masked figures, but it also involves pilgrimages to holy places. And this particular quote here I'm going to read you is interesting. It says, "The ancient history of the four western pueblos is intimately tied with the upper Little Colorado River Valley in a manner still little understood by archaeologists. This is epitomized in the continuing use of religious shrines, especially a shrine area near the confluence of the Little Colorado and Zuni rivers. Known to the Zuni people as Kolowelawa and to the other western pueblos as Wainima, this area has many ceremonial associations. It is the birthplace of the Koyomeshi, mudheads, an area related to the Shilako, and a sacred area with many shrines used in Kachina religion. In English, the Zuni sometimes refer to Kolowalawa as Zuni Heaven because this is the location of Kachina Village, where tribal members dwell in the afterlife. The fact that Kolowalawa, or Wainima, is still used by all of the western pueblos more than 700 years after the last ancestral village on the upper Little Colorado were occupied attests to the abiding veneration and spiritual significance of this area." And this was written by T.J. Ferguson in Southwest Archaeology Magazine. So here we have people making long-distance pilgrimages to this area. Another interesting thing about this area is the use of sacred clays from this area. Now, this is a quote from Matilda Cox Stevenson, who was an early anthropologist that lived at Zuni. She said, the personator of Kayaklo has his body painted with the pinkish clay found near Kolowalawa. She also said, in crossing a low mountain not far from this lake, this is the lake that's at Kolowalawa, several pieces of pinkish clay were collected. This is greatly prized by the Zuni, who believe that if the smallest portion should be parted with, no rain would again fall upon the land. So I'm not making the association that this pink clay from Zuni heaven has any relation to the Salado necessarily, But I am saying that there's precedence for sacred clay being collected on holy pilgrimages to this area. So here is the timeline for the events taking place here. So about 1030, we have Sholo Black on Red began being made in the Puerco River of the upper Little Colorado. This was made for a long time. And then about 1275, things really start to happen. Pinto polychrome and Pinedale polychrome first start to be made, and there's massive social reorganization in the western Cibola region, White Mountain, Mogollon Rim area. 25 years later, Gila polychrome springs up in the southern southwest, below the rim, and at that very time, the massive social reorganization begins along the Salt and Gila River valleys. 25 years after that, Kachina images first start to appear on pottery and rock art. And then, about 25 years later, we have Ponto polychrome begins to be made, and then in 1400, we have the complete abandonment of the Mogollon Rim area. And about 50 years after that, the complete abandonment of the Salt and Gila River valleys. So we have kind of an echo going on. An event happens above the rim. 25 to 50 years later, the same event happens below the rim. And this goes on from about 1275 to about 1450. So let's talk about Salado polychrome production. In Ceramics and Ideology, Patricia Crown proved that Salado polychrome was made across a wide area of the southern southwest. So before that, people would speculate and say that maybe Salado polychrome was all being made in the Tonto Basin or in the Globe area and being traded across this broad area where it was found. Patricia Crown showed through petrography that Salado polychrome was being made in every valley. There was Salado polychrome coming out of the Safford Valley. There was Salado polychrome coming out of the Cliff Valley. There was Salado polychrome coming out of the San Pedro Valley, and on and on and on. So she proved that it was made across this broad area. Well, it seems that after that study came out, a lot of people seem to assume that Salado polychrome was made everywhere it was found. And this is not so. A 2014 report by Ownby, Huntley, and Peoples showed otherwise. Here's a quote from that report. Production of decorated ware at Kuykendall, Buena Vista, Curtis, and Gila Pueblo was not conclusively demonstrated. The sampled perforated plate from Gila Pueblo has sand temper compatible with the local geology, as confirmed by comparison with sand samples collected near the site. So these are major sites, okay? Kuykendall is, if not the largest, one of the largest Salado-era sites in the Sulphur Springs Valley. Buena Vista Curtis is, if not the largest, one of the largest Salado-era sites in the Safford Valley. Gila Pueblo is one of the largest Salado-era sites in the Globe area. So these aren't just small sites. And yet when they look at where the Salado polychrome was made from these sites, they could not find any that was made locally. So this shows that Salado polychrome is being made at specific locations. In fact, in the case of Kuykendall, not only was none of it made there, but most of the pottery was being shipped in large distances. Almost 20% of the Salado polychrome at Kuykendall was being transported from the Cliff Valley, which was nearly 150 miles away. So it seems that certain villages had access to the white slip, or perhaps controlled sacred knowledge related to the production of this pottery. Let's talk a little bit about this white slip. Salado white slip is special, because without that white slip, Salado polychrome would never have been made. Without Salado white slip, we would never be talking about a Salado culture or a Salado phenomenon or Salado people or Salado potters. It's all based on Salado polychrome pottery. So it's very special. The other thing about Salado slip is it has this unique ability to hold on to organic paint. A unique ability because most clays don't do this. You might even think that these qualities, the qualities of turning organic paint into black designs, are magical. They're definitely special and unique properties in this clay. Rare, extremely rare. White clay is extremely rare south of the rim. White clay that holds organic paint in an oxidizing fire is extremely rare anywhere you go. After 30 years of searching for the white clay that holds organic paint, the white slip used to make Salado pottery, I was ready to give up. In the winter of 2018-2019, I had looked everywhere. I'd looked in every valley across the region. I'd done hundreds of test firings. Most of the clay turned out to be too yellow, too brown, or did not turn organic paint black, or was not clay at all, was gypsum or some other white material. This map shows the list I'm keeping track of all the places where I've collected and tested white clay. So I was about to give up because I had pretty much run out of places to test. I can never be sure I've looked everywhere because this is a vast area, hundreds and hundreds of square miles. Besides the fact that the place where they got their slip could not exist anymore. I mean, what if the slip was coming from someplace that is now at the bottom of Roosevelt Lake? Or what if it came from an area that is where the open pit mine now is in Miami, Arizona? So the point is, it's possible that the white slip doesn't even exist anymore. It's under a parking lot, right? Or that it's just some obscure place that I just didn't happen to go. I can't go everywhere. But the facts are, I've looked a lot of places, a lot of places, and I hadn't found anything that was even remotely right for what I was looking for. And so I think chances are it's not in the Southern Southwest. So the question is, if they were trading it in, where would it likely have been traded from? And that's when I started looking at this upper Little Colorado River Valley, because this is the area that had a really strong cultural connection to the Salado. It's where Salado Polychrome started. It's where oxidized organic paint pottery started. It's where the designs that we find on Salado Polychrome came from. So there's a lot of connections to that area. We know that there was a lot of trade in those times, but it's hard to track a lot of things. Parrots, for example, don't leave a lot of evidence of their passing. Cotton leaves very little evidence of passing in trade. One of the things that archaeologists have been able to track is obsidian. When Salado Polychrome starts appearing in these villages, along with it starts appearing lots and lots of obsidian. And archaeologists have been able to study that obsidian and tell exactly where it came from. And so a lot of the obsidian, at least in the eastern Salado area, comes from Mule Creek, New Mexico. So I looked at the lower San Pedro River Valley here, Reeve Ruin being one of the primary ruins in that area, and measured using Google Maps. You can get walking directions to anywhere between Reeve Ruin and Mule Creek, New Mexico, where that obsidian was coming from, and I have a walking distance, according to Google, of 150 miles. That's pretty far. Then I looked at the study we'd already talked about that showed that nearly 20% of the Salado Polychrome, finished Salado Polychrome pots, found at the Kuykendall ruin, had originated at Ormond Village up in the Cliff Valley, a walking distance of 140 miles. Now, obsidian is heavy to carry. You fill a backpack full of obsidian, you know it. You've walked 150 miles with that obsidian. Pottery is not so heavy, but it's bulky and it's fragile. So another difficult thing to transport for long distances. Slip, on the other hand, slip is light and it's condensed. So a small piece of slip could slip many, many pots. So I could take a backpack or a basket full of slip 150 miles and I could have enough slip for several villages, maybe for the whole year. Well, how does that 150 miles play out the other direction then, up towards the Little Colorado River? On this map, I've located the areas where we know that Salado Polychrome was produced. The red dots down here are places where petrography has shown that Salado Polychrome was actually manufactured. I've used Google Maps walking directions, which routes through existing roads and trails, so ancient paths may have been shorter, to St. John's, Arizona, which is the most southerly portion of the Little Colorado where these Chinlay Formation smectite clays are found that would be sufficient to turn organic paint black on pottery. If we go from the Tonneau Basin to St. John's, it's 160 miles. That's pretty close to the distance that, say, the obsidian was coming, right? Or the pottery that was coming from Cliff, New Mexico to Kuykendall. Pima, which is near the area where most of the Salado Polychrome was manufactured in the Safford Valley, to St. John's, 170 miles. This particular one, because it crosses some remote parts of the reservation, the roads go way out of the way. I'm sure this could be a lot shorter in ancient times, not following existing trails through that area. And Ormond Village in the Cliff Valley to St. John's is 150 miles, the same distance they were transporting pottery south to Kuykendall. This 150 miles gets you right into the cradle of oxidized organic paint pottery. It gets you to the Chinlay Formation, an area full of these smectite clays which are critical to holding organic paint and turning it black. And it gets you right into the birthplace of Salado Polychromes. So in the spring of 2019, I made several clay expeditions to the Little Colorado River Valley looking for this white smectite clay. And these yielded promising results. I found lots of white clay. Some of it held organic paint exceptionally well. The picture on the upper right is me at Table Rock Ruin, which is a site where there's a lot of Salado polychromes, Gila polychromes, and Tonto polychrome, right on the Little Colorado across the river from St. John. So what you might even call a Salado site right on the Little Colorado. And then the picture on the bottom right shows one of my test bowls, and those are the clays that I got up on the Little Colorado. And you can see those whites are exceptionally good at holding organic paint. The reds not so much. If Salado polychrome pottery is in fact connected to the white clay coming from that Chinle formation in the upper Little Colorado River Valley, what are the possible implications? It would prove that Salado had a strong and ongoing throughout the era connection to Puebloan culture above the rim. It would indicate that the Salado ideology, what Patricia Crown called the Southwest regional cult, was connected to the Kachina religion potentially. If this white slip was not religiously connected, if it was just a trade item, then it may have been in exchange for a trade surplus that they had between North and South. You see, below the rim, they had things like cotton and shell that were in demand above the rim. So this white clay could have filled that trade deficit. On the other hand, if this white clay did have religious connections, then it could show that this slip with magical properties may have been obtained on pilgrimages to sacred shrines in the north. And it may also possibly explain what happened in 1450 with the abandonment of the entire southern southwest from Phoenix to Chihuahua, Mexico. In that, if it was religion, then that could be a pull. Like people want to go live in Zuni or Hopi because they have the true faith. Or it could be a push. In that, if religion was dominating the people, if, say, Zuni priests or northerners were coming down and kind of controlling the southerners with religion, then there may have been a rebellion against that, and they would pull south, and that would leave that no man's land in between. So there's a lot of possibilities. If you have questions, leave them below. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this.